So I failed the whole three-day challenge thing pretty miserably. We did not capture Africa, but we did capture quite a bit of territory before our great leader died, and that's what this episode's going to be about. We got this kingdom down here at Adai Crew. Although I will say we could become Africa's only emperor, and we could make the Empire of Guinea. We need to create or conquer another kingdom. We need 500 gold, which we do have 441, but most importantly, we need 77 counties inside the Empire of Guinea. We only have 25. So yeah, we're going to have to do quite a bit of expanding here. Also, one side note is at the end of the last episode, I married our heir to this girl who's 43, and apparently once women get to 45, they are infertile. Thankfully though, soon after marrying J-Plo, she ended up becoming pregnant, which was really lucky. I think we married her when she was 42, so it's only been a year. Big shout out to our son for doing the impossible, although, I mean, he is beautiful, so that increased his fertility. But yeah, J-Plo has the genius trait, which increases stats by quite a bit, and increases monthly lifestyle XP by 30%, which is gonna around double their amount of XP they get, so they're gonna have an insane amount of perks. Speaking of wives, our great leader's wife is now 46, so I guess judging by what the comment section said, even though I'm not really seeing it anywhere here, like there's nowhere it says that she's infertile. Oh, and here we go, I found a chart that looks pretty legit, and it's saying what people are saying in the comment section. Females that are 46 and older have no chance of having kids. Apparently the primary wife has doubled the fertility of secondary wives and like concubines, did not know that. And women are apparently most fertile between 16 and 25. They lose a bit between 26 and 30, and then they lose quite a bit after 30. This is really good to know because our great leader's spouse is 46 now. She only pumped out 3 kids. She was chaste, which lowers her fertility by 25%, but she was beautiful, so I thought it would counter that, but I don't know, we just didn't have that many kids. We're gonna divorce his wife for 100 piety, which is fine, we have 600. And our great leader's only 35. He's still 100% fertile. At 36, he becomes 90%. Up till 41, he becomes 80. So like, yeah, he's gonna be cranking out babies for a long time, so let's find him a young wife. I think this girl, Miriam, might be our great leader's best option. She is quick, which is an okay trait. It's not intelligent or genius, but it still does increase monthly lifestyle XP. And also when we do end up marrying her, our great leader is only going to lose 100 prestige versus marrying a lot of people will lose 300. Okay, here we go. Apparently our kid and this girl, J-Plo, who now is infertile, I guess, they had a kid and there's a good chance the kid is a genius. The reason why this is so big is this kid is going to take over our kingdom one day when our son does eventually die. Oh no, he's just comely. I was doing a bit of testing and I saved right before she had the kid, and if the kid really sucked, I just reloaded as I want to test out what it's like to play with a genius ruler. Obviously this run is now illegitimized, but I mean, this is not Iron Man anyways, so for all you guys know, I got this on my first attempt. Evidently, there's around a 50% chance to pass down a trait. However, that does not mean it's a 50% chance for the kid to be genius. From what I was noticing, there's about a 50% chance for the kid to be genius or any of the traits under it, like quick, and second tier version of it was intellectual, I think. And like our kid actually did pass down his beautiful trait, only the tier 2 version of it though. So our grandson will be handsome and a genius. And this is the kid we're going to play as when our leader and our kid does die. That all being said, I'm going to try to pick up the pace of this run. We did expand west a little bit. We took out this county completely. For free, we're now attacking to the east, and this guy actually has a lot of troops, or at least his allies do. He's got 2 allies now. I'm pretty sure one of them has a mercenary company because they just have way too many troops. Like, yeah, this guy has 314 bush hunters, which means that's part of a mercenary company. I'm actually not sure if we're gonna win this. Like, we have 2579 troops over here. Most of them are bush hunters. Well, I'd say like half. And these guys are also going for capital. It looks like they're gonna run though, or they're gonna actually be really smart here. They're gonna group up. Thought they were going to be dumb, but no, looks like that's not going to be the case. We don't actually really have to fight them because over here on the east, we're sieging their castle. So we're going to see what they do here. Are they going to go back for the castle? Yep, they are. So we're going to have to cut them off here, or they're going to make it there way quicker than us. We're going to have to run with these levies. They're probably going to get killed. I put a commander in their army that increased their movement speed. So we're going to hope that allows them to run. They're making it out, I think. Meanwhile, our army down here is sieging their castle, and like they're actually sieging us, but it doesn't matter. If we take both this guy's territories, the war is over because the guy we attacked only has 2 castles. Like, yeah, his ally has a bunch, but we don't have to mess with his ally at all. So every 5 years, you can switch your focus and you can actually change trees. I decided to change our lifestyle over to the marshal for a bit so we can pick up Bellum Justum, as that lowers the cost to go to war by 50%. With this new perk, it's gonna allow us to wage much larger wars. Like, we can attack this guy over here at the Duchy of Sapi. Feel kind of bad though, because this guy is our friend. We have a 100 relation with him. Unfortunately for him though, attacking his duchy is gonna give us 4 counties, and it's only gonna cost us 188 prestige now. The dude's really strong though. He has 1847 troops and he's got an ally that has 943. So this might be a bit difficult. I just noticed though, we do now have 4.2k troops. I believe that's due to the fact that we just picked up Exalted Among Men. As we expand our territory, we're gaining levels of fame, and with the tribal faction, you get huge bonuses for having a really high level of fame. Your vassals end up giving you a ton more troops the higher fame you are. The one we're at, Exalted Among Men, is the fourth highest. There's only one higher, the Living Legend. So this war actually went really smoothly. We ended up capturing this territory, and this one is capital, and they had 37 troops that were just kind of going back and forth. They weren't sure whether or not they wanted to attack us or go for one of our other territories, and I just kept moving these almost 3,700 troops back and forth and just kind of mirroring these guys, and that was enough to deter them from attacking our levies that were just sieging. We ended up capturing the guy's daughter, and that's going to be it for the war. We also can't even ransom her if we wanted to. So yeah, war's over. I was talking about fame earlier. We got 150 fame for that because it was a pretty big war. It was a war for a duchy, so they gave us more fame, and yeah, we just got four more territories off of that. That was pretty huge. All right, so here's our territory now. We've been winning a lot of just kind of smaller wars. Nothing too crazy. Our leader is 48 now. He is getting kind of old. He does have the Tree Spirit's Blessing, though, which is increasing his health for five more years, I guess. We're currently taking out this duchy. We're actually almost done. It was a really easy war. This girl did have a lot more territory earlier, but we've been just attacking her nonstop. Well, we captured her spouse, I guess, and she's going to ransom him for 50 gold. Very nice. Oh no, this is really bad. We just got a peasant revolt, and they're about to take our capital. And there's really nothing we could do because we were in a war on the east side of our territory, and this was just so far away. Oh god. We just lost one of our daughters, and our lover, Beantu, died. Okay, well that sucks. Unfortunately, the daughter that died was not this lover's pox-ridden filthy animal. It was our beautiful daughter, Yana, who was engaged to Yadigamosi, a Herculean dude, and now he's betrothed to this girl. Oh, can't win them all, I guess. All right, so we're continually expanding our territory. We're fighting a war over here on the east, and we're kind of space-rolling anyone we come across. We've been fighting a lot of battles and taking a lot of prisoners, and I noticed a lot of these guys are not of our faith. And this is kind of interesting. So we lose 17 stress if we execute them because we're zealous. We're kind of like a holy warrior and we really hate people of other faiths, but we're also just. So we gain stress. We gain one extra stress actually. Yeah. So we're going to start executing these guys. A lot of them anyways, like especially the older guys, we don't really care about them. 20 dread for this guy too. Or we could actually ransom this guy for 10 gold. I didn't see that. Most of these guys I've already checked and made sure that we can't ransom them. This guy's actually pretty good. PC Londuma. He does have a 2-star physician trait, and apparently our physician died, so yeah, this is gonna be really good to get a free physician, and we'll appoint him as our court physician for 10 gold. And this guy actually has 18 prowess. Okay, we're not gonna execute that guy, but like this kid we can execute for 10 dread. This guy Penn and Wayne actually has 18 prowess too. Okay, we'll let him join us even though he's kind of old. But yeah, after doing that, we're now almost at 45 dread, and a lot of our vassals are now terrified of us, so they will never oppose us directly. There's other things that dread does, but it's generally good to have. Okay, so we just got 100 gold from ransoming one of our prisoners. I really don't know why. Like, it didn't look like he was a vassal of anyone or anyone important really, but either way, we called the spirits again, and we're gonna do the first option this time. It's gonna cost us 75 gold, but the spirits will definitely take notice of this offering, and it may draw the attention of a powerful spirit for good or ill. And I'm thinking that we really want some powerful spirit buffs for our leader as he's getting kind of old. He's 55, and it looks like we didn't get any crazy buffs. We just got the Tree Spirit's Blessing again, which I've seen this every time, and I got this even when we didn't spend any gold on this event. It still is really good though. It gives us a medium boost of health, so the guy should live a while. All right, so we expanded our territory a bit, and we got enough fame to become the Living Legend now, and that's going to increase our levy cap up to almost 8k, which I don't even know if we need to let it cap out. I think we can just straight up attack Yorboland. His territory, by the way, does not look that big, but his counties are all really bunched up. Also, if we wanted to invade like Ghana, we'd only be getting this much territory. And like, I'll just zoom in over here. You can see like their territories are kind of spread out. Like there's 16 territories we'll be getting if we attack Ghana. And down here, Yorboland would be getting 14 territories. I also like the terrain at Yorboland a lot more. It's much better for our bush hunters as a lot of it is jungle and forest. So yeah, this is gonna be a much better play for us. We can also suck one of our allies into this war for 350 prestige, which we're gonna do because we're getting a lot of prestige and we don't really have anything to spend it on right now. Oh wow, so our son had a lot of interesting traits. He had gout, apparently.
So I'll give you a perfect example. 2 years ago, ladies and gentlemen, out of nowhere, my foot swelled up, was incredibly, excruciatingly painful. I couldn't believe it. I was like, what is this? I've never had this happen before. I asked around my family, has anyone ever had this happen? Everyone says no. And then later on, I found out they do. It's hereditary in my family. I tell the doctor all my symptoms, and she says, sounds to me like you have what's called gout. And it's rare for someone your age. Like, usually older guys would get it in their 40s or 50s, maybe only being in my 30s. You know, it's very rare that I would have it. And by the way, do not type gout into the stream chat. You will get kicked. So what it means, gout, is that you have a high acid levels in your body. And basically what I had to do was do lifestyle changes. I stopped eating red meat all the time, which I used to do all the time. I mean, I'm not even kidding. There were weeks where one day I would have steak. The next day I would have a burger. The next day I would have sausage or a meatball. The next day I would have like pasta with some kind of meat in it. You know what I mean? So I would be eating red meat like constantly. And that's very high acid levels in the body. Or also shellfish. Shrimp, lobster, crab, all that. Very high acid levels in the body. And it just so happens the day that this happened, it was my birthday week, and I had had a ton of shellfish. I had had these like shrimp popper appetizer plus a pasta that had shrimp in it. Then I ate red meat for like 3 days. Acid overload in my body. X-rayed my foot, did blood work because she just wanted to be sure it wasn't something crazy serious or anything, you know. All the tests came back exactly as expected. You have it. You have gout. So, you know, she prescribed an anti-inflammatory. I'm not kidding you. Not one thing that happened that day was covered under my insurance. And by the time it was done, I had paid $1,300 for 1 day at the doctor, going to just the doctor checkup, x-ray, blood work, and getting the prescription. $1,300. With me having insurance, paying hundreds of dollars a month for insurance. That's the healthcare I get because I'm self-employed.
He's also inappetitic. Stress ruined his appetite and he skipped meals and started wasting away, which that didn't affect his health. And neither did being an adulterer, but being a drunkard did give him a tiny health penalty. And yeah, that was all too much for our kid. I will say it's not the worst thing though. We do gain a stress level, but we can manage that. By downing some hashish cakes and we'll go into a hashish stupor for 3 years and we just lose one stewardship, two learning. Not a big deal. Our kid passing actually wasn't the worst thing because his kid is now going to be our heir and this kid's the genius and he's handsome and he also is apparently a wise man. But yeah, so we're invading this guy and I made kind of a mistake for calling our ally to war here because this dude has 626 troops only and his ally is not helping him really. Well, his ally only has 326. We did take out like 1,000 of his units in a battle and okay, this is the army that's left over. They're now going to try to attack us from sea, I think. And okay, there's some more troops over here. Maybe those are raiders. Also, our ally that we called to war was fighting his own war and I guess he's done with that. But yeah, he didn't really help us here. That was a waste of prestige. And here he comes. He's finally gonna help us out, but it's gonna be, well, not too late, I guess, but almost too late. He helped us with 4% of our war score, even though we were taking this castle anyways. And yeah, that was a really easy war. So we need 10 more territories to make the empire. In order to pick up 4 more, we're going to attack this guy over here. And we're taking out his duchy. We're able to get 4 counties here with just taking on his duchy. If we do attack his duchy, and that's actually going to bring us down to 250 prestige. We're getting kind of low on prestige. There are a few things we can do to boost it, and we might explore those after we're done with this war, which we are actually almost done. Okay, well, that was quick. We captured their heir, and we can ransom him for 1 gold. No thanks. We'll just end the war. All right, so here's our Kingdom of Daikru, and we just need 3 more counties in order to make the Empire of Guinea. We're going to attack these guys down here at Igaboland, and we're invading their duchy for 5 counties, actually, we're going to pick up if we are successful here. I will say they are defending against 2 wars, and they have no allies, so even though they do have 3k troops, it shouldn't matter. And yeah, we got 8.3k troops, so you can imagine this won't be too difficult. I also did notice that our marshal is still doing this thing, train commanders, which actually isn't that good, I think, just for where we are now, because we only have 1,200 men-at-arms, and that's lowering their monthly cost. And we do have a 9% chance each month to find a new commander or a knight, but I've noticed these people aren't super amazing that we find. I mean, they're somewhat decent, but I think this thing would be way better. Organized levies, just because we have so many levies now. This increases the levy size, garrison size, and reinforcement rate by 32%, which is a lot because we currently have 8.3k on the map right now, and I think that buffs up to 10.5. It also gives more levy reinforcement rate too, so we're gonna get them back quicker. Like, we already bumped up by like 150 levies there. Wait, what? We just captured their leader. We could ransom him for 57 gold, or we could just end the war right now. I think we should just ransom him because 57 gold is still a lot. Like, we are at a pretty insane amount, 1300. But I also just don't foresee this war being that hard to win. Like, we already got 22% war score. But it seems like these guys are pretty preoccupied. I don't know what they're doing over here attacking us with 600. Oh, here we go. There's 1400, which unfortunately for them is not gonna be enough. We have 5k. And yeah, here's their armies, I guess. 1400 and then 1365. Oh, we don't want to go that way, actually. Oh, we're going to take attrition. I didn't mean to do that. We're going to actually lose 240 troops. But that's okay. It's not going to be too game-breaking. We're about to demolish half this guy's army. And then Now these guys, and I think that's it. But yeah, this war is over. We took the guy's son as prisoner too, so that's another 50 gold. So that was actually pretty profitable. And yeah, winning that war for the duchy gave us 5 more territories. That was the biggest duchy I've ever seen. And that's going to be enough to form the Empire of Guinea. We do need another kingdom title though. We only have one. I guess we didn't get the kingdom title from taking out Yorubaland. That's okay. It's not the biggest deal. It only costs 150 gold to make a kingdom title. We'll just make one at Yorubaland, I guess. It gives us a bunch of prestige too. And yeah, after doing that, we have all the requirements needed to make an empire now. So we're going to do that for 300 gold only. And we are now Mighty Akanhin. After doing that, we increased our men-at-arms regiment limit, and I think we might pick up some pikemen here because they counter cavalry, which do counter our bush hunters. I feel like cavalry at this point are our only weakness, so yeah. Oh, okay. And our great leader died at age 69. Because of that, we did lose quite a bit of prestige. I was not ready for our great leader to die because he had a bunch of buffs that were increasing his health, so I was assuming he was going to live longer. 69 is still pretty old though, and yeah, now we're succeeded by our grandson, who, by the way, has 29 in learning. A lot is going to change now, though. Our soldier limit went down to 14k. We were at 20k before. That's because this kid has basically no fame. I mean, he is almost distinguished, though. But yeah, we're going to have to climb back up to the living legend eventually. And yeah, I'm going to end the episode right there. It did seem like this episode was really smooth sailing, because it was. But I was noticing the Muslims declared a jihad on, like, the Byzantine Empire. And this is what a jihad looks like. Pretty much all the Muslims are attacking this guy. And I'm wondering if they could declare a jihad on us once we expand more. So yeah, there could be some difficulty there in the future. And with that, I want to thank you all for watching. If you would like to see an African conquest, then drop a like. Let me know in the comment section. I will be focusing on ascension for now, but if I do another episode, then expect that within the next few weeks. Thank you all for watching, and I will see you then.